In this video, we'll be looking at some common mistakes that are made when installing LED floodlights, how to avoid them, and how to maximise the lifespan of the fittings. We'll be using these brand new fittings from the BG Luceco Castra range, which has been completely redesigned from the ground up, avoiding older, less reliable technology. Now, if you're interested in outside lighting, how it's covered in the building regs, and how these fittings meet those requirements, then please check out our free CPD on Partel over on eFIXX.co.uk. On with the video. Those of us who've been in the trade for a long time will remember that our go-to outside light fitting was this type of monster. Now, this one's seen better days, but they used to be everywhere, and they relied on old-school tungsten halogen lamps which used to dissipate so much heat that they'd flay your fingers if you didn't let them cool down enough, had the added bonus that if you touched the lamp with bare skin, you'd reduce its life, and that if they weren't installed pretty much horizontally, then the gas would collect at one end and again shorten the lamp life. The lamps came in various power ratings, with a smaller size at 150 watts and larger ones in 300 and 500 watts. I remember when I was an apprentice fitting them, I always wanted to put in the 300 watt version as they used less power and would be better for the environment. But one of the sparks I knew always made a point of putting 500 watts in, as he thought that if other people used more power, it would help him keep his electricity bills down. However, of course, these old fittings were wildly inefficient, and we now have lighting solutions that provide light while using much less power. Of course, we're talking about the LED floodlight. There's no doubt that this type of light fitting has increased the efficiency of our outside lighting installations. However, it's also fair to say that because LED floods are one of the biggest areas that adopted LED technology, there is a vast spectrum of quality available out there. Some from the very cheapest end of the market can be sourced from the factory at just 59 cents each, which means that the quality is very variable. Combining this with the fact that the technology in an LED fitting is about as far removed from the old halogen lamps as the space shuttle was from the Wright Flyer means that there's a few more considerations to take into account when installing them. Let's consider some. The first thing to think about is where the fitting is going to be installed. The temptation when you're installing is to take a one-size-fits-all approach, find the best value fitting you can, and install it. However, if you're installing a flood to, let's say, an agricultural environment, it's likely to experience much harsher conditions than one installed to the side of a house in a sleepy suburb. If the fitting has been designed to cope with the kind of environmental influences you'll find in a domestic outdoor setting, it's likely not going to be appropriate for a harsher agricultural setting, meaning that if you install it there, it's likely to fail prematurely. Another factor to consider is the amount of time that the fittings are intended to be used for. Domestic floods are not designed to be left on permanently, and using them in this way will shorten their lifespan. If a fitting is being used in a commercial or industrial application where it will likely be used for long periods of time, then using a less expensive domestic fitting is a false economy, because it just won't have the longevity that you expect of it. So there's the first point. Always make sure that you install the correct fitting into the correct environment, and that's going to maximise the lifespan of the fitting. Another thing to think about is IP ratings. Sometimes you find floodlights that have been installed to illuminate a building by pointing upwards to create a light washing effect on the wall. Generally speaking, a floodlight is not designed to be used pointing upwards. When they're being tested for IP ratings, they tend to be tested in the position that they will be used in, which is from the horizontal to close to vertical, but not upside down. Now, obviously, whether the fitting is protected against splashes or jets, it's designed to take those from any direction during the IP test. However, the problem occurs when water starts to pool in places that it shouldn't because it's been fitted in the wrong position. Pooled water is a problem for electrical fittings, especially outdoor ones, because infrared heat causes any gas inside the fitting to expand and contract, and as it does so, it can start to draw small amounts of water through any seals that are in place from the water pooled on the fitting in certain places. This is obviously a problem and can lead to failure of the fitting due to water ingress. This is not down to poor seals or bad engineering, it's physics and using the fitting in the wrong way. Another issue with fitting floodlights upside down to shine upwards is to do with heat management. Now, this is a floodlight from the brand new Castra range from BG Luceco, and as you can see, it's got these fins on the back here that help to dissipate the heat generated by the LEDs. This is absolutely vital to making sure that the fitting continues to operate correctly for a long time. And again, it's not designed to be used upside down, which means installing it in this way can reduce the lifespan of the fitting. One of the other disadvantages of illuminating buildings in this way is light pollution. That amount of light being lofted into the sky will contribute to that hazy glow that you see over towns and cities at night. Big steps have been taken to reducing this effect in our streetlights and building regs, but by finding alternative ways to light up external features, we can play our part too. However, as well as big picture light pollution, we can also look at it on a smaller local level as well. How often have you seen it done when a neighbour mounts a ludicrously overpowered floodlight on their house that seems to illuminate your windows more than it does their garden? Of course, floodlights are designed to be adjusted, and this new fitting from BG actually has a really innovative ball joint connection on the back of it that allows you to tilt it and angle it wherever you want. However, looking at the lens on the front here, what's often referred to as the optic, it's designed to throw light forward in this direction as well as down. And that helps to cast the light over a large area and reduce glare for the end user, as well as remove the need to tilt the fitting up a lot to get a good spread of light over a large area. This will reduce the amount of light overspill that occurs onto other properties and maintain good relations between your customers and their neighbours. So there we go. Installed correctly and used in the right applications, the new Kestra range of LED floodlights from BG Luceco will give years of service. But as always, we want to hear from you on this subject. Do you have any other tips for using LED floodlights? Are you looking forward to using this new range of LED floods from BG Luceco? And just a reminder, if you're interested in outside lighting, how it's covered in the building regs, and how these fittings meet those requirements, then please check out our free CPD on Partel over on eFIXX.co.uk. All that remains in this video is to say, thank you very much for watching.